So welcome back to the afternoon session. We have a very special and exciting portion of the program for you today. First, we're going to hear from Jimmy Robbins, and then we're going to have an interactive panel discussion with some real experts in causal inference. So it's my great pleasure to introduce our next speaker, Jamie Robbins. Jamie is the Mitchell and Robin L. LaFoyle Dong Professor of Epidemiology in the Department of Epidemiology here at the School of Public Health. And I think most of us in this room agree and know one of the founding fathers of causal inference and the reason that many of us are here. And so I have the distinct pleasure of introducing Jamie, even though many of you probably know him better than I do. Jamie is in the category of people that I try and stay around. They're called high entropy people. And this means that it's hard to predict exactly what they're gonna say next, but whenever they say something, it's usually very interesting and also very insightful. I also consider myself lucky that I think I've already had the canonical Jamie Robbins experience. I came to him with a problem that me and my students were working on, and he said, oh, I wrote a paper and solved this problem 10 years ago. Why don't you go check it out? And he was right. And the only thing for us to do was to go and make marginal tweaks on a core Jamie idea. And so I think that in a nutshell is sort of the Jamie Robbins experience that many of us have had at some point in our careers. So with that, it's my great pleasure to hand it over to Jamie and hear what he's going to say today.
All right. Well, it's nice to be here at the founding convention of CAUSALab. Not since it Port Huron, and that's an inside joke to boomers. Okay, I'll start. So if causal experiments are randomized experiments, how do we know we are right? Answer, we don't. I'm ready for questions. how do we determine how successful we're being and how do we adjust our methods to become so? Okay, so this is going to be what I call an aspirational talk, which is what if we did not have resource constraints in terms of money and most importantly, trained causal analysis experts with substantive scientific knowledge and judgment. And an aside for the beginning, one of the most important benefits of starting the causal lab is that it will, through training of grad students and postdocs, create many more causal analysis experts who will hopefully put. So the opportunity to train a lot more people and put maybe I'll have to pasture like you would. Okay. So how do we tell what works when and where? I'd say when and where, referring to that we're always asking in the context of a particular causal question in the database. So how well we do it can be constrained by many things, sample size, the rigor and confidence in its data collection, standard challenges. Things like is confounding by indication likely large? Is the effect of treatment or an adverse exposure likely small on the risk ratio scale, but still important from a medical public health perspective? Because it's a common disease, that makes it much harder. Are the outcomes well validated? Are student measurements frequent enough? Measurement error, and so forth. All these things you have to take into account to decide whether you think you can recover, a chance to recover causal effects. Then here's another aside. Another major benefit of establishing a causal lab is that the best experts in causal analysis will participate in answering important pressing causal issues based on best data. So causal methods don't work if the data is any good, but historically the people working in causal analysis, forefront, often could not obtain access to good data. In fact, given my long background in the field, here is a not uncommon historical vignette. I think much more rare than it used to be, but I don't know how uncommon it still is. So a specialist academic doctor could capture a large group of patients with given disease, say like the head of rheumatology, someplace like the Mass General. And you can then patients were brought up home, so you can make a research career by publishing clinical papers, often based on observational data, not running a trial. Based on those patients, and you never share the data. Why? Because often the doctor was not well trained in design or analysis. So the doctor's only relative advantage was possession of a scarce resource, which they were not about to give up. So, and also some would rely on non-cutting-edge analysts who are loyal, who understood the subtle hints to make the paper publishable and important. As a consequence, this valuable data source was often used to publish incorrect results while withholding the data from analysts who could correct them. It's a very problematic situation, at least to be in for science. The interesting thing is these same doctors, rheumatologists, would be vocal that only randomized trials, not observational studies, could be trusted, without recognizing they themselves were contributing to the fact that observational studies are not to be trusted. So, and similarly, in epidemiologists, investigators who started large cohorts often would not share the data. Again, this was a valuable resource. Again, interfering with the self-reflected correcting requirements of science. And indeed, a lot of the things we've worked on in the Causal Lab, like when to start, it wasn't the Causal Lab then, but when to start, what CD4 count to start antiretroviral therapy in HIV infected patients. The original papers, which were usually from clinicians, the analysis was so flawed. I'm not talking about they weren't using our cutting edge methods, they weren't using Epi 101 methods. They, either had lead time biases or world person time biases. And yet these were the papers because these people had the data. They weren't asking anyone else. They were publishing things that were false. It was a very bad situation. So now things are changing for many reasons, focusing on one, that the emerging understanding among several physicians and the community, public health, that the design and causal analysis of complex longitudinal studies requires trained specialists, no less so than, say, open heart surgery requires a specialist. And my evidence is our director, Miguel, who has become a recognized expert in causal methods. People have understood they actually can give better and different answers. And so he's been asked to participate in the design analysis of many observational studies of COVID during the pandemic, including the recent important studies of vaccine efficacy using the Israeli healthcare system data, which was the best data there was. And 10 years ago, a well-trained group of Israeli experts would not seek the help of an outside epidemiologist. It just wouldn't have happened, whether they have needed one. The world's really changing. And so again, the growing visibility and academic reputation of the causal lab, until we destroy that, will increase the number of similar collaborations, which is good for everybody. So what do we want? We want to provide what are we really trying to do? To give a quantitative, I'll put a question mark there, a degree of confidence as to whether the analytic results we obtain for the current state-of-the-art causal analysis methods are sufficiently reliable to have a significant role in decisions concerning medical or public health decisions. For example, to change treatment recommendations or to regulate environmental exposure. Or we just say, analysis, more data needed as the alternative. Is it possible for that to happen? And if so, how? Before continuing, we need to address a misunderstanding that always arises at this point. People say things like, you cannot establish causality from a single study, especially observational. Rather, meta-analysis must be done. More importantly, different kinds of evidence have to be brought to bear, triangulate different kinds of evidence before reaching a sound causal conclusion. And among that evidence, very important ones are biological plausibility. And I think that just undermined what I said. I never understood that. I couldn't agree more. But what are we asking? We're asking, does our analysis provide independent evidence from those of sufficient reliability to inform the process of triangulation, if you want to call it that? I mean, the worth of our evidence is our evidence. It's not, you know, worthless is going to make things worse. In my experience, and when I'm talking about what we have to do, something like, you know, Cochrane collaboration meta-analyses, they're not what I mean. I mean, when I read them, they analyze reliability of different evidence by a checklist of which designs are said to be most reliable, without going into the meat of what was really done and how a given study was designed and analyzed. Okay, so what would it even in principle mean to do this? Well, to obtain a measure of confidence, abstractly, we'd like to do a meta-regression, where we regress some measure of the units of the studies, okay? And where we regress some measure of the difference between our observational estimate of the causal effect and the true causal effect on study covariates, that is, encoding the magnitude of the various constraints of the study being analyzed, like, you know, how often did they collect data, you know, what was the size of the effect people felt likely, what was, what did they do about measurement error, how much, blah, blah, blah. Okay, so those are the covariates. And there are many problems with implementing such analysis. One obvious one is we don't know the true causal effect. Makes it a little hard to take the difference. And the best one can usually do is to use the results in an RCT as a surrogate for the truth. And then we have to, I don't know how much to spend on it. Why don't I go to the rest of that? I go through here a lot of details about what are the possible ways to try to make RCTs closer, or make, I'll go through a little bit. Okay. Well, how do we make a RCT surrogate as close as possible to the true effect in our observational populations? Because that's what we're analyzing. Well, first thing, we emulate the actual randomized trial done using our observational data as closely as possible. Eligibility, health, treatment outcome are defined and measured, and so forth. So we make it look like it's trying to do the same thing, you know, when we analyze our observational study. However, our study may differ from the RCT population in the distribution of measured and unmeasured factors. Measured factors we can sort of adjust for inverse probability weighting in various ways. The only way to address the difference in unmeasured covariate is to coordinate the RCTs with observational studies. For example, in settings where the number of eligible studies for an RCT is greater than the sample size required for that trial, one could enter a random sample. The eligibles in the trial conduct a parallel observational study on the remainder. Miguel has some experience with this, and I asked him about the panel discussion. And that's because I don't remember all the details he told me last night. But anyway, and that's, you know, that means, you know, you have to have a lot of cooperation with the people actually doing the trial when they're doing the trial. So this is an easy problem. And then outside of coordination, there have been multiple randomized trials, so one can get a sense of how close one could expect to be to a randomized trial benchmark by analyzing the heterogeneity effects on the trials themselves. More ambitiously, one can get the access to the trial data. You could use the trial data from each trial to emulate itself, each of the other trials, as if it were the observational study, and compare how well it emulated to how well your observational study emulated each of the other trials, just to get some sense, are you in the ballpark, or are you someplace else? Okay, and it's crucial to understand the factors that make successful emulation impossible as well as possible. So they're equally important. I know. Okay. So what was the last thing I wanted to say? Yeah, that's another point. To know which kind of studies you don't want to take a guess at. You know the data, the structure is too bad that you're never going to, from experience, you'll never be able to get reliable causal effects. That's maybe more important to know than the other direction. So, and then I'm just going through some other interesting questions. One big question I've seen debated in most important forums in this country called Twitter is if you're hoping to use analyses, people take observational analyses to people take seriously for decision making, you know, causal inference, should the observational analysis be prescribed in the same way, pre-specified, in the same way RCT analyses are in the RCT protocol? And a lot of people I've been reading who say yes. I think that's bad idea. This isn't a randomized trial. And I don't think this is a totally clean way forward. Well, I think we have a lot more to learn. But one way forward is to take a much more algorithmic approach to what will be done if various analytic problems that wouldn't arise in a randomized trial, at least in ordinary life, arise. What are you going to do about outliers, about missing exposure data, and so forth? And the responsibility is to keep a record of every single analysis performed, whether reported in the final paper or not, so that later, if somebody thinks you were cheating, they have the whole record in front of them. If the 18 minutes of that record disappears, you get impeached. Okay. And you should also analyze the observational data in many ways, even the standard ways you quote know to be wrong, like adjust for variables affected by treatment. Because if the results differ, it will help kill old unjustified methods, as we experience positively with the analysis of HIV data, because it was so much confounding by indication, and the confounder was an intermediate variable that other than, using gene methods and stuff, people were getting even the wrong sign a lot of the time compared to the randomized trials. And if they differ that way, if they do not differ, the data set was not much of a challenge. And then differences from the RCT are more likely due to unmeasured confounders that you'll never be able to adjust for, because it doesn't seem that it's important how you massage the data. It's just the information's not the data. And again, as examples, we could successfully recover certain RCT results for, say, something like breast cancer. It doesn't have a lot of unmeasured confounders, but not for all-cause mortality, for which there are all sorts of things that you have data set. And so all this means a different organization of the causal lab, though it'll probably, this is the hardest thing to do in academia, is to have a subgroup of the lab, part dedicated to deep dive. I never use terms like that, but I've been hearing it too much lately, even I, any of those kinds of terms. But what causes differences in various analysis strategies and which line up best with RCTs? There's so many analysis strategies out there. You don't want to just be doing one, because it's better, and other people will tell you it's not if you aren't experimenting with them all. Okay, so we need such a subgroup, the kind of people who will spend weeks, months analyzing a single data set in many different ways as data for a general view of what works and what doesn't, and when things work. And it's hard because all the glory in academia comes from analyzing new studies or new reanalyses of studies for their substantive conclusions and getting interesting publishable results. So this kind of research, everybody says it needs to be done, but it's never done because of, you know, promotion and recognition issues. Should be, it could be interesting. Let me see what else is here. Yeah, this is a point I wanted to make that, you know, there are really two different things you're using your randomized trial. There's the issue of, did your analysis of the observational data give you what you thought you were trying to estimate? So that's, then was what you were trying to estimate from the observational data causal, or were there unmeasured confounding or other screw ups that you would never agree with the randomized trial? And those are really two logically different things. And the point is, have you analyzed the data right on its own terms? Is actually something that's much more internally possible to do, especially in causal inference, because causal inference has this beautiful fact that you get it right if you either know the outcome model or the treatment model. And so you've got two ways to analyze the data, and they have to agree with each other. That is, if you had an infinite sample size and did it non-parametrically, they agree with each other. Now, in real data, these complex longitudinal data sets, they're very high dimensional. So you have to use all sorts of models and stuff. And if you get a different answer from inverse probability weighting, which is, uses only, models only the probability of treatment, versus the G formula, which models the outcomes, then you know you made a mistake. That's the beauty. The equality of those two ways of estimating the same causal effect actually has nothing to do with causality. It's just a fact about any joint distribution. These two ways of estimating that particular functional to the G functional estimate should give the same answer. So, and a third way is to use doubly robust results, but which will get it right if you get either of the group of models right. But again, this is all academia. There are all sorts of people who say you should just use doubly robust estimators and forget the rest. But the real question is, no, I mean, you don't know what's right. And if you're getting differences between any of, you know, unless all three essentially agree, you know you have model misspecifications. You have the data, so you can improve the models. The question is how to improve them without, you know, cheating, but to get them to come closer. I mean, so for example, when you're comparing, to start with, to see if you need to, when you're comparing inverse probability weighting to the G formula, you really should separate your group. The two sides should not know what answer the other side's getting. So that, you know, you should do an experiment, like it's a blind thing. And so you should design how you're going to do this. I don't know all the answers yet. Okay. Almost done. I just said all that. Yeah. So I said we have a tremendous amount to learn about the empirical performance of all these things. Most comparisons of different methods even are in methods papers. They're often simulations, and they're only there for one purpose, to show that author's method is better than other people's methods, and they pick the simulation to prove it. Believe me, I mean, that's not wrong. I mean, they aren't trying to analyze the data set seriously, and no one is seriously doing the research that knows anything about the robustness of these methods and so forth, because no one's self-interest is in doing that, because that takes time from away from creating new methods. Again, this is, again, I'll make this point, it's very good to invite visitors to the lab, but think they have alternative better approaches and do the comparisons head to head. That's, you know, getting stuck with, you know, one hammer, so you always see, say, nail, and promote it. Then we also wait for the day when everyone is randomized at every patient encounter in medicine, a big change to medicine. And then they're just basically instruments, you know. There's some place to, you know, hold on to, and you know, I'm sure if researchers have their way and convince doctors like we're doing that they should do serious research, maybe this will happen one day. That people really do lots of randomization. There's any uncertainty. This is the last thing. This is one suggestion I had is we should make up a questionnaire, send it out to, you know, all people in causal inference in clinical medicine and epidemiology, ask them to tell us what are the five big errors made by observational studies, you know, when they learned later they were wrong, and their opinion of why these errors occurred, what studies they were in. Five great success stories of observational epi and how they were later confirmed. Want that from them. Want examples from them of randomized trials that were misleading in their results not being applicable to so-called real world, whatever the word is, for all the usual many reasons that randomized trials may not be, because it would allow us to create a database of just the kind of studies that people are most concerned about where there's a problem. And those are the ones we want to get our hands on now that people may be giving us data that they know gets treated a little better. It would give us a database in many fields in medicine about controversial issues where observational studies believe to have gotten it wrong, and gives us an opportunity for reanalysis, target trial methods, to see if it was in the data or in the analysis. That's all I had to say. Oh, and yeah, that's all I had to say. Okay.